So today we shall start our discussion on green chemistry. If anything will be left out, it might require another lecture, or otherwise I think today's lecture would be enough to initiate you into understanding and abreasting you with the idea of green chemistry, the branch of chemistry which has come to fore. Probably we have discussed its why this branch of study in within the chemistry has emerged, because most of the problems associated with the use of chemicals and chemical processes were directly it was felt in common parlance that chemists and chemical industries are responsible for all kinds of problems. Of course, that is true to some extent, but not everything. Chemistry has made our lives easier, and it is only when any process becomes unsustainable, then problems related with hazardous effects or deleterious effects of chemicals and chemical processes on the human health, especially, and environment, of course, arises. So I'm first going to share the first slide on green chemistry. Can you see this slide?
Yes, sir.
So it is, one is only we will discuss some principles and examples. We are not going to become, you will not become an expert of the subject. Of course, it requires more longer association with chemistry, of course. Which most of you will leave after this semester. As we had discussed in past also, life without chemistry cannot be imagined. So probably it would interest you as it is directly associated with today's majority of the problems with which technologists and policymakers are actually confronted with nowadays. So it is very important from that point of view. As mentioned, sustainability is what? Meeting the needs of the present generation without compromising the needs of the future generations. Since the capacity of Mother Earth is limited, it can only take care of the waste, for example, waste generated in any process, any industry. Is a definite amount, and if that amount exceeds, then the problems arise, and so sustainability is the term which you will find everywhere, whether you are reading a latest economic magazine or you are reading in every walk of life, every field of knowledge today, the first and foremost question is question of sustainability. How, carbon dioxide, now the burden of carbon, it has far exceeded than it can be, taken care of by natural processes, natural decomposition processes, or what you call degradation of hazardous gases. All these things take place. It takes time. So since the industrial age, the burden of the carbon dioxide has increased, and it has increased multifold in last 40 years, especially. And that's why this alarm, that's why this commotion that. We are witnessing there. There is no need to provide you the data, but now it is visible everywhere that we are witnessing the kind of climate change and related problems, which are if it will keep on going with this rate, then best optimism, we can give another 40-50 years to this planet. Beyond that, earlier it was thought that the end of the 21st century or maybe next 200 years the human civilization is safe, but now it is very, very bad news, in the sense that we have to drastically reduce the emissions of unwanted gases, especially carbon, in the environment, should be curtailed in order to sustain the so that the life goes on all innovations and better future. The green chemistry has come into existence already some 30 years, already 3 decades almost. This idea of chemists themselves have started finding remedies or substitutes of hazardous chemicals and chemical processes. And in this last 25 years or so, we have definitely achieved. There are success stories, many good stories are there to prove that yes, we can do it. We can definitely make a difference, and we can. We have learned from the mistakes of the past. So what is green chemistry? The technologies that are energy efficient, minimize or preferably eliminate, emphasis is on eliminate the formation of waste and avoid the use of toxic and or hazardous solvents and reagents, etc., where possible, and utilize at the same time renewable raw material. So in other words, the minimization of waste and hazards associated with use of chemicals and chemical processes is what the green chemistry is all about. So green chemistry, it means, very, very, very clear it is. It means primary pollution prevention and not end of the pipe remediation. So it is different from what a civil engineer or environmental engineering student studies about the remediation, final remediation of certain things. It differs in the sense, green chemistry, that before a substance or process becomes unsustainable, the amount of any substance, hazardous substance or hazardous chemical process becomes unsustainable, we should stop it, or we can replace it with more environmentally friendly process. That is the aim. So the experts of various fields, of course, chemists themselves, have identified while this green chemistry as a subject study was established in early 90s in last century, last decade. These are the, I mean, within the, there are some principle. What principles means? The areas. When you have some principles, it is something like aims or areas in which you have to work within that. The greater idea of green chemistry was mooted, and then within that idea, some principles were brought to fore before everyone, and this is these are well known in green chemistry, in green chemistry, in introduction of green chemistry. It is important to know about its 12 principles. As you can see, prevention, that is one of the major goals of green chemistry, prevent it. I mean, prevention is better than cure. So prevention itself, as far as possible, do not use hazardous substances or hazardous chemical processes. So prevention, that is the first inherent idea. Then atom economy, as we will be, you will be, I mean, we will see in detail right after this slide. Or so atom economy, what is atom economy? It is you can say, theoretical idea of assessing or making best use of substances, reactants, and economize the waste by calculating beforehand how we can maximize the mass or product generated. It is not percentage yield of the product, as we will see, but atom economy is one of the ideas within the reaction mass balance. You might have come to this term, reaction mass balance. What is this? Reaction mass balance is, if we start with one mole of any substance, we should end up with one mole of the product. That is the conservation of mass. So reaction mass balance is ideal thing, but in practice, it does not, since processes are not efficient from many angles, we end up with, along with our desired product, we end up with some waste, unwanted waste, which we don't want, but that is obvious. So if we, this is one very important atom economy and E factor. It is not written here. We will see further in a couple of minutes. We will come to that. Atom economy and E factor are two principles based on the principle of reaction mass balance. you, if you have pencil and paper, you can write it down. Less hazardous chemical synthesis. Of course, this is one of the principles of green chemistry, designing safer chemicals, safer solvents and auxiliaries, design for energy efficiency. Of course, any process should be energy efficient. As we know, use of any technology, it is the energy and material with which we deal with. So use of renewable feedbacks, some sources of reactants, feedbacks means the resources which we utilize in order to get something. So and if those resources are renewable, that one of the aims or principles of green chemistry. Then reduce derivatives. What are derivatives? Derivatives, suppose a product P is formed with reactants A, B, and C, then if we can synthesize our desired product P without using all three, A, B, and C, suppose we eliminate the use of C or B or A, one or two reactants we eliminate and still get our product, then it is the reduction in the derivatives which produce our desired product. Catalysis, it should be on top of the 12 principles. You can easily put it on top, catalysis. This is the branch of chemistry, you know, catalysts. You know very well what are catalysts and what they do. They reduce the reaction time and make the reaction energy efficient. At the same time, waste is not generated. So the best, all kinds of within all principles, catalysis is one area which chemists have to address everything. Any problem of chemical reaction or reactions which yield the product at in bulk quantities are they are used in industry, of course. So simply, if you use use of catalysis in various industrial processes, you are already aware of many processes which are very well catalyzed. Use catalysis of different kinds to get maximum yield or product in a cleaner form. So catalysis, in my view, you should write on top of the 12 principles before anything. So design for degradation, if you are designing something or your product should be degradable, you can understand the use of plastics now have become a burden on our society and environment. So many fields are in material science and chemistry are focusing on the use of biopolymers instead of these organic well-known organic polymers. So biopolymers are degradable, and so that is another area in which chemists are contributing a lot. Real-time analysis for pollution prevention. That means real-time analysis. We should, though it is beyond the scope of the green chemistry, as we have understood that green chemistry should be applied beforehand. Before we go for producing something in industry, and which ultimately creates some kind of pollution, air pollution, water pollution, soil pollution, and even upper atmospheric pollution, which is very life threatening and unsustainable in nature. So though pollution prevention beforehand, if we are using any eliminating the use of any hazardous substance or chemical in industry, then of course we are contributing in the reduction in the pollution, of course. So but make it clear, pollution, controlling pollution is not our aim in is not aim of green chemistry. Controlling pollution is not aim of green chemistry. Other areas are where we can chemists can contribute. So real time analysis is 24/7 monitoring of all kinds of water resources and our agricultural fields, some types of soils, and of course quality of air, etc. So in, you might have seen now we have 24/7 hour monitoring of our quality of air all over world now, and developed countries are monitoring every water source, whether river, freshwater lakes, and all kinds of water bodies which are monitored 24/7. If anything is dumped, suppose a river passes through more than one country, 2-3 countries are there, many major rivers globally flowing through more than one country. So if anything is dumped, unwanted chemical is dumped or pollutant is dumped, thrown into it, if we are monitoring it regularly, then we can find, immediately we can detect that chemical and raise the alarm, the issue will be brought to the fore of the industry, which is releasing that kind of unwanted product in it. Rhine River in Germany, for example. All these countries are very closely closely situated, and if anything is dumped in Germany, it would be detected immediately in Netherlands, and since the monitoring of the water bodies is being done 24/7, so real time analysis is that, and we are also doing it for important we are doing it in for example in case of air pollution, we are doing it 24/7, and we are of course regularly monitoring the water quality of major rivers, etc. Definitely this is one principle of green chemistry, inherently safer chemistry for accident prevention. So overall, finally, inherently safer chemistry we should use so that accidents do not occur, like Chernobyl nuclear plant disaster or Fukushima, Japan, and Bhopal chemical fertilizer plant, and so on and so forth. accidents are a regular feature in all kinds of industries, especially chemical industries. The explosion of boilers takes place every day. Newspapers are filled with such news, accidents occurring in various industries, especially use of chemicals. Wherever something is compromised and proper maintenance and upkeep of the plants is not carried out, then accidents due to human negligence occur. But if in chemical industries, we can eliminate somehow we can find substitutes of hazardous chemicals, then the loss due to accident, loss of material, human life and other precious resources would not occur. So this is about 12 principles. Now next slide is not expansion. Actually, it is written. You can see on the heading of the slide. Green chemistry expansion. It is not expansion. It is, in fact, we minimize the points. We mix the points. Merge the points, 12 principles, and see in which area which principle contributes. So it is not expansion actually, but it is called expansion in the sense that where the in 12 principles, where which principles have common, they overlap objectives of each principle are clear when we write 12 principles. But there are principles, more than one principle can contribute to a common objective. That is shown in this slide. So materials, for example, if you take material, in terms of materials, the principle of reduce derivatives, catalysis, and atom economy and E-factor. E-factor, you should add it here itself, E-factor. What is E-factor? We will discuss in a short while. So, materials deal with, these principles, catalysis, reduced derivatives and atom economy are related with the mass, that is the materials. Then energy, important, very important, materials and energy. The two important pillars on which any technology is based. So energy is comes in various, everywhere. Energy efficiency is one principle, of course. Then in catalysis also, we save lots of energy. When we reduce the derivatives, the amount of reactants we reduce, then again we are saving some energy. And analysis, what is analysis? I don't remember why this this is there. Maybe energy, overall energy uses is analyzed, or then volatile organic compounds. You see, one of the major sources of pollutants are volatile organic compounds, which are used in very, very large bulk quantities in millions of tons worldwide, globally. They are produced and transported and used in many industrial processes. So volatile organic compounds, if we take this put focus on volatile organic compound, then we will find that two principles, that is safer solvents and less hazardous chemical synthesis, will come into these two principles it is hidden that somewhere we are aware of the use of volatile organic compounds, which are so hazardous, so their effects is so deleterious, especially air pollution they cause is enormous. Again, we will not go into the pollution aspect of anything. Remember, that is the we have to remain in our territory, that territory is actually green chemistry. Waste, again, key term used in green chemistry is waste. Prevention, atom economy, catalysis, design for degradation, reduced derivatives, analysis and prevention are all principles which aim, their overall aim is to minimize the generation of waste, or if possible, altogether stop the generation of waste. Then plants are industrial plants which make use of chemical processes. So design for energy efficiency, these plants should be designed for energy efficiency. Again, you can see this move is preemptive move. We can preempt something happening beforehand. So if we design the plant itself in such a manner that it is energy efficient, that is the we are contributing towards the greener aspect of industry. Process intensification, you understand this. Risk and hazards. Now waste and hazards are two important terms in green chemistry. So risk, minimizing the risk associated with the use of chemicals and chemical processes and hazards associated with them is one of the chief objectives, main objectives of green chemistry. Design safer products, safer solvents, renewable materials, and inherently safer chemistry. Overall, inherently safer chemistry. If you have taken care of the things beforehand, then obviously you need not to face the consequences of using chemicals, hazardous chemicals. And now coming to economy comes everywhere. Economy rules our every action, every decision is influenced by economy. So cost is design for energy efficiency. Cost is involved. If something is energy efficient, you will save some money. Reduce derivatives, you are saving the money. You are not utilizing excess resources in producing some desired substance or desired product. Waste prevention and atom economy and waste prevention, overall, everywhere, all these things lead to overall more economic process. You cut the cost in this manner, and you see, since making profit is the aim of every human activity, is of course that is required. Any intelligent technocrat will use all kinds of expertise within his capacity to address these issues and, of course, help the economy. And again, coming to the expansion, or I will call it compression, of the 12 principles. All 12 principles reduce the environmental impact of any chemical or chemical process. So everything, every principle, every area in which these 12 principles can be used has been shown in previous slide. It is well known 12 principles of green chemistry, and then reducing this to focusing on materials, energy, volatile organic compounds, waste, plants, risk and hazards, cost, etc. Overall, it's a focus on important things. So many principles, they contribute to one particular aspect of our any technology, for example. So these aspects are called expansion, or I will call it compression of the 12 principles. Now coming to, yes.
Also, I have a question. Could you explain what process intensification is?
Process intensification is, anything which can be done with the reduced time, for example, with more efficiency. So that is, I do not understand this process intensification more than this. Probably, those who are engineers who are working in industry, they can explain it better. They may be knowing it better, but for every process, make an audit of the process, you will find some sluggishness, some drawbacks in any process you will find. And if you remove those drawbacks, you are actually intensifying the process. That is, so it is more related with industry than what we are talking about chemistry. So
okay.
Now come to major principles, which second principle, atom economy and E factor. We are coming to it. Yes. What is atom economy? Or it can another term can be used, but atom economy is a common term used. It is atom efficiency, and how it is related with reaction yield. You might be aware of about the percentage reaction yield. You write when you study in organic chemistry, well known organic reactions which are potential industrial which can be carried out at industrial scale, definitely mention percentage yield of the product. So that means if a percentage yield of product is 80% yield, that tells us that one starting with 1 mole of reactant, we have ended with 0.8 mole of the product, and 20% of of the reactants have got converted into undesired, unwanted waste. So percentage yield is again related with the efficiency of the process of the reaction. in terms of mass. Mass. I mean, if you are using every atom within your reactant to get your desired atom, then at that scale, you are actually getting benefited, and you are minimizing the generation of waste. That is the principle, that is the aim, that is the objective of green chemistry. So see this reaction, for example, a hypothetical reaction, whereas reactants A, B, and C are giving you the desired product P plus U, unwanted product. Then what would be atom economy? Atom economy is theoretically is the molecular mass of the desired product divided by the molecular mass of all the reactants, whether A, B, C, D. Suppose you are mixing six reactants, seven reactants, n number of reactants, then the molecular mass of product, if you divide it with the molecular mass, that is molecular weight, let us put it more simply, the molecular weight of product, if you divide with the molecular weight of the all the reactants, then it is called atom economy. You will get a percentage, of course. If you multiply it with 100, this ratio, then you will get a percentage atom economy, and that percentage tells us it is something like percentage yield of the reaction, but it is not percentage yield. In last slide, we have to compare what is percentage yield and what is atom economy. You should be very clear about it. Percentage yield only relates with one of the major reactants. When we calculate the percentage yield of a reaction, then we calculate the amount with which we started with A, B, or C. Anyone can be a major reactant in A, B, C. Suppose A is the major reactant, then we will calculate the percentage yield with respect to the amount we started the reaction with is A. 1 mole of A should yield 1 mole of P, but instead we get 70%, say 75% of yield, 0.75 mole. So that is percentage yield is different idea. Atom economy is absolutely different idea in the fundamental principle of reaction mass balance. So reaction mass balance here is, remember, write down, both these principles, atom economy and E factor, are related with the idea of reaction mass balance. If you have pen and pencil, write it down. Otherwise, you may forget about what this atom economy and E factor relates to. Obviously, it relates to mass, but we are using it for assessing the efficiency of the reaction. So that's and both E factor also. E factor is another idea, not very old idea, applied to the processes or industrial reactions which we are using for getting something. Here, if you divide, Mr. Sheldon is responsible for, person. Sheldon put forward this idea of E factor, which is E is not electronic, but E is the here environmental quotient. E factor is actually environmental quotient. So in short, it is called E factor. So the idea here again, if you divide the molecular mass of the waste generated in any chemical reaction with the molecular mass or molecular weight of the product, then you get a ratio, a number you get, and that number tells us about the, again, about how much waste it has generated. We will see it with examples in next slide. See, for example, percentage atom economy is equal to relative molecular mass of the desired product divided by the relative molecular mass of all the reactants multiplied by 100. Suppose there are two routes to produce a molecule called malic anhydride, and this can be produced by oxidation of benzene or butene. So in first reaction, if we calculate the atom economy, in first reaction, it is a balanced reaction on paper, of course, theoretical one. And we are getting our malic anhydride, which is important intermediate in production of many, many drugs and polymers. So this example of green chemistry should be from the reactions which are of industrial importance. Although theoretically, since it is a theoretical approach, we can apply it to any reaction, and we can evaluate the percentage atom economy or efficiency of the mass transferred from converting reactants into products. So for this, if you calculate the molecular weight of benzene 78, 16 multiplied by 4.5, and then molecular mass of malic anhydride, you can calculate, and then you know the molecular mass of carbon dioxide, you can calculate 2H2O, everything, because the percentage atom economy is the ratio of, I mean, sorry, it is, yes, I mean, it is the products divided by mass of all the reactants. Mass of the product divided by the mass of all the reactants. Not mass, actually, molecular weight, actually. It is not in kgs. Molecular weight, relative molecular mass, that is molecular weight. So if you calculate this, you will find the percentage atom economy for this reaction, the first reaction, where also you can see carbon dioxide is being generated. This looks very innocuous, very simple, very, very harmless while writing on the paper. But actually, in practice, when you use this reaction for the production of at the industrial scale, when this reaction is carried out, a large amount of several thousand tons of carbon dioxide may be involved in just releasing it into atmosphere. And so the idea of atom economy helps us decide. In second reaction, the oxidation of butene, it is much better reaction. There is no side reaction or waste generation like CO2. Water is a harmless byproduct in second case, and we are getting our product, same product. So percentage of in the first reaction it is 44%, in second reaction it is 64.5%. Anyone can tell that the second reaction is energy efficient reaction. And mass, as far as mass is concerned, it is more economic. So percentage atom economy is more in second reaction. We will choose second reaction for generation of production of malic anhydride. at industrial scale. So what is E factor? First is E factor is it is explained, it can be explained with the environmental quotient, that is the total mass of the waste divided by the mass of the product. So suppose this is overall reaction is production of ethylene oxide, another key intermediate in industrial processes, is generated, produced or synthesized by two important methods. One is chlorohydrin method, which uses chlorine and lime along with water, and we get ethylene, chlorine and lime. And in second energy efficient process is when only catalyst is used, ethylene, for example, oxidize it in presence of ethylene in presence of catalyst, and you get the ethylene oxide. And so in first case, E factor, that is the molecular mass of the waste is the molecular weight of CaCl2 and water divided by the molecular weight of ethylene oxide product, our major product, we get a E factor of 2.5. And atom economy is also very low in the chlorohydrin method, that is only 25%. And atom economy catalytic production of ethylene oxide is 100%, and E factor is zero. So E factor should be zero for any, ideal chemical reaction or process. So and what does this E factor of 2.9 indicates in the first case, the chlorohydrin case? It indicates that in generation of 1 mole of ethylene oxide, we have to tolerate almost 3 times of the waste generated along with it. So that is the E factor given only in this idea, only not very old. Now the auditing of the you can assess any industrial reaction on the basis of these two parameters only, and green chemistry that's why it has been chosen as one of the major principles of green chemistry. Thank you very much. Today, for today, it is enough. We shall discuss it. Few examples we will take in next lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Just a moment. Wait. Don't go. I have to record the attendance. Just a moment. First stop.